You're listening to the audio production of Am I Making Myself Clear? Secrets of the World's Greatest Communicators by Terry Felber, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Christopher Ragland. This book is dedicated to my best friend, my wife Linda, who has taught me through her love and encouragement how to serve people through thoughtful words. Preface. As we were both growing up, my wife Linda and I remember thinking that we wanted to live a life of significance. We didn't want to look back at the end of our lives regretting what could have been. We didn't want to pass through this life just existing, just putting in our time. Ron Perrier, a mentor to thousands in our business, calls this a life of no regrets. It became clear to us that if we were to make a difference, it would be through our relationships with others. We came to learn that much of our fulfillment in life is based on our ability to connect with people in a real way. We have come to understand that communication skills are the key to our success in this area. We became associated with Amway, owned by founders DeVos and Van Andel families. Over the past 25 years, Linda and I have interacted with hundreds of thousands of people, whether through sports arena presentations or through individual relationships. Our lives have been wonderfully enriched by the thousands of friendships that have ensued. The following are excerpts from a letter I received not long ago. I'm writing to thank you for the difference you've made in my life. I've never told you much about my past. As I was growing up, the other kids I was around made fun of my looks a lot and the fact that I was homely. I never had any friends and kept to myself. My parents fought all the time and constantly criticized me. When I was a teenager, I frequently thought about suicide. Things weren't much better as I approached 30. Then I met you and Linda. You talked to me like you really cared about me. You encouraged me to do more with my life and told me you believed in me. I had never heard that before from anyone. It was like walking out of a dark building into the sunlight. I now believe I can do great things because of your friendship. I'm forever grateful. We all have the ability to make a difference through our kind words and uplifting speech. Linda and I have had great friends and mentors in our lives, such as Theron Nelson and Ron Perrier, who have equipped us with the tools whereby we are able to successfully develop impacting relationships. This book shares those communication skills with you in the hope that, through your successful relationships, you also will have a life of no regrets. Chapter 1. The Art of Communication. There may be no single thing more important in our efforts to achieve meaningful work and fulfilling relationships than to learn to practice the art of communication. Max Dupree, Leadership is an Art. Abraham Lincoln is considered by many to have been the greatest American president. Winston Churchill has been regarded as the most inspiring English statesman in history. Johannes Gutenberg has been named one of the most influential men of the last millennium, and Mother Teresa is recognized the world over as an outstanding humanitarian. What has made the lives of these individuals so different? What is it about these persons that has set them apart? Certainly, it is a combination of many factors, including passion, determination, faith, circumstances, and a positive attitude. But there is something else, a something rare and yet available to everyone on earth, that turned a gangly lawyer into a world leader, changed a stuttering adolescent into a catalyst for allied peace, enabled a simple newspaper man to transform the way the world thinks and helped a frail woman give hope to thousands. That special something is the lost art of communication. This is more than simply talking to another person. The art of communication is the dance that we have with others. It involves our words, our actions, and our intentions. It is a two-way dynamic that relies on our vigilantly watching and reading the other person in order to determine the next step. The individuals listed earlier all engaged in this dance, and because they did, they were able to deliver their incredible gifts to the world. A new generation of world changers is alive today. Every one of us, including you and me, has been placed here on Earth with a special set of talents and insights that can benefit people. Don't let yourself be content to rock away your best years with drifting thoughts of what life could have been. Grab hold of your destiny. If we could only communicate our ideas well, our world would dramatically improve. Our jobs would become more satisfying, our bank accounts would grow, our marriages would be happier, our families would be healthier, our minds would be sharper, and our overall quality of life would be brighter. As you listen to this book, I invite you to enroll in the School of Communication. As you determine not only to study these principles, but also to actually apply them, I guarantee that your life will change for the better. You're a good candidate if you're a parent who would value more meaningful conversation with your teenager, you're a wife who would enjoy more time and attention from your spouse, you're a salesman who wants to close the next deal, you're a husband who would like more affection and zest in your marriage, you're a student who hopes to have your choice of jobs after graduation, you're an employer who would like to cut turnover, you want to be the person God made you to be. This book will teach you the significance of what you say and how you say it. If you embrace and practice the skills taught in this book, your life will be transformed. The possibilities for fulfilling your potential will be limitless. Not only will you have ideas that can change the world, but also you'll have the skills to communicate them. We've all seen the results of poor or inaccurate communication. Poor instructions, a failed exam. Poor posture, a lost job opportunity. Poor listening, a rejected sales offer. I love this true story of professional golfer Tommy Bolt, who, while playing in Los Angeles, had a caddy with the reputation for constant chatter. Before they teed off, Bolt told him, "Don't say a word. If I ask you something, just answer yes or no." During the round, Bolt found the ball next to a tree. He was going to have to hit the ball under a branch and over a lake to land it onto the green. He got down on his knees and looked through the trees to size up the shot. "What do you think?" he asked the caddy. "Five iron?" "No, Mr. Bolt," the caddy answered. "What do you mean, not a five iron?" Bolt snorted. The caddy rolled his eyes. "No, Mr. Bolt." Bolt hit the ball with the five iron anyway, and the ball stopped about 2 feet from the hole. He turned to his caddy, handed him the club, and said, "What do you think about that? You can talk now." "Mr. Bolt," the caddy replied, "that wasn't your ball." That's the way life seems to work sometimes, doesn't it? Breakdowns in communication are all too common. The primary reason families struggle is poor communication. USA Today recently published the eye-opening results of a study on teenagers and stress. When the teens surveyed were asked where they turn for help in times of crisis, the most popular choice was music, second was peers, and third was TV. Amazingly, moms were number 31 on the list, and dads were number 48. These teenagers obviously experience little ability to connect with their parents in a meaningful way. According to another survey, married couples have nothing to talk about after only 8 years of marriage. Professor Hans Jürgens asked 5,000 German husbands and wives how often they talk to each other. After 2 years of marriage, most of them manage 2 or 3 minutes of chat over breakfast, 20 minutes over the evening meal, and a few minutes more in bed. By the sixth year, this was down to 10 minutes a day. A state of almost total speechlessness was reached after the 8th year of marriage. There is the account of a woman who went to a lawyer saying that she wanted to divorce her husband. The lawyer asked, "Do you have any grounds?" The woman said, "Yes, we have nearly 3 acres." He said, "No, ma'am, you don't understand. I mean, do you have a grudge?" She said, "We most certainly do. It's a 3-car garage. The lawyer tried again. "Maybe I'm not being specific enough. Does your husband beat you up?" The woman said, "No, I generally get up a 30 minutes before he does." By now, the lawyer was frustrated. He said, "What I need to know, ma'am, is why you want a divorce." "Oh," she said, "that's easy. My husband just doesn't know how to communicate." Other surveys tell us that over 80% of the problems people encounter at work are related to a breakdown in communication. Think of it. If we could just discover the secret to successful communication, we could avoid 80% of the challenges that occur in our professional lives. The 21st century is alive with technology. There are more and faster means of communication today than ever before. We can send emails across the world in seconds. We can phone our friends from the tops of mountains. We can connect live via video to people thousands of miles away. And yet the chasm between our current situation and our future opportunities seems to grow bigger and bigger. In spite of these incredible tools of communication, we have failed to learn the art of communication. My hope is that this book will build a bridge between where you are today and where you want to be. As you listen to this book, there will be PowerPoints set apart in each chapter. These are specific nuggets of information that can be applied to your communication arsenal for immediate results. I encourage you to highlight these points and to practice them in everyday situations. Chapter 2, The Art of Unspoken Language. There are 4 ways and only 4 ways in which we have contact with the world. We are evaluated and classified by these 4 contacts. What we do, how we look, what we say, and how we say it. Dale Carnegie. When we study communication, we usually think in terms of words and phrases. In fact, many times it's not what we say with words, but what we say with our faces, our eyes, and our bodies that most impacts the listener. Knowing how to articulate and use words is a powerful weapon in negotiating your dreams. But mastering nonverbal actions in tandem with your words will render you unstoppable. Demosthenes, the famous Roman orator, was asked, "What is the first part of oratory?" "Action," he answered. When asked what is the second part, his answer was the same, action. The truth is, people tend to believe actions more than words. You may have heard someone say, "His action spoke so loudly, I couldn't hear what he said." It's true. Actions do speak louder than words. Prudence Leith, caterer and restaurateur, tells this story in her book, "Pardon Me, But You're Eating My Doily." My favorite catering disaster is the true story of the couple who went to the Far East on holiday. Besides their own supper, they wanted food for their poodle that they had taken with them on their vacation. Pointing to the dog, they made international eating signs. The waiter nodded, picked up the poodle, and set off for the kitchen, only to return 30 minutes later with the roasted poodle on a platter. This story, tragic as it is, illustrates the importance of clear communication. As you will discover, communication is as much how you say it as it is what you say. In the previous story, the couple consciously used nonverbal communication to get their point across, albeit unsuccessfully. In our everyday communication with families, friends, and work relationships, we unconsciously communicate nonverbally all the time. In fact, it's been said that we cannot not communicate. This means that we are always communicating, whether we are consciously trying to or not. The fact that we aren't talking doesn't mean we aren't communicating. Recent studies have shown that we communicate a mere 8% of what we are trying to say through our words and as much as 90% through our actions or nonverbal activities. Think about it. We smile in pleasure. We wink to imply intimacy. We scowl in disgust. We stand tall in confidence. We cower in fear. We point in accusation. We slump in frustration.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.